I will focus my comments on the S&T lagging countries referred to earlier by Jaco Pallis. These are 80 countries, including the 50 least developed countries and 30 other low-income countries, including big countries like Nigeria, Bangladesh, Indonesia, and Ethiopia. These countries have been identified by TWAS as lagging behind other countries in the world in the area of research and development, especially research capacity. And as was mentioned earlier by Jaco, 25% of humanity live in these countries. So these countries, in addition to low capacity in science and technology, are also facing immense sustainability problems, such as food, health, energy, and water security. That was, again, referred to by Dr. Kumaja. And in my view, their greatest challenge is how to build and sustain capacities in science, technology, and innovation to solve real-life problems facing their nations. So when it comes to education and training, in my view, the major problem facing these countries is that of quality and excellence, both in scientific research and education. For example, not a single university in the 80 countries I just mentioned is listed among the top 500 universities in the world, not a single one. In addition, the contribution of research papers published by all the 80 countries in international journals in the year 2007 is only 0.85% of the world total. This is actually equivalent to the contribution made by a small country, Israel. So you can see how weak these countries are, and that's why they have been carefully identified as countries that really need a lot of attention by all the organizations that really want to support science and technology in the developing world. So that should really be the primary focus. And promoting quality education and training in these countries, in my view, in the final analysis, is the responsibility of their governments. We can help from outside, but the major responsibility really lies in the governments themselves addressing this issue. But as I said, support from other countries, both in the north and in the south, will certainly go a long way in promoting excellence and relevance in educational research in the S&T lagging countries. So what I really plan to do is just to highlight three concepts of action that I feel are essential to promote excellence in education and research in these S&T lagging countries. First, reforming and strengthening universities in general and scientific education and training programs in particular is critical in building research capacities in the 80 countries. Of equal importance, I feel it is important for each country to have a university that can be recognized internationally as a world-class university. That would mean they should strive to uplift at least one of their national universities, leading universities, to such international standard. Because such world-class universities is the only mechanism to attract and retain the best and brightest students in the country and offer them high-quality education and training. It will also set standards for quality and excellence for other universities in the country to follow. So that's my first point. My second point is the complexity of sustainability problems, these problems I just mentioned, coupled with the advancing frontier of new fields in science, technology, and innovation, call for curricular reforms and new methods of education and training to produce what I call the 21st century generation of problem-solving scientists and engineers. Now, this is really something common for all countries in the world. Even advanced countries need to address this issue of curricular development and introducing new ways and new methods of teaching science. At the school levels, new methods of education in which students learn how and why instead of memorizing results should be introduced. An excellent example of these new learning methods is the one developed and promoted by the Global Network of Academies of Science, IAP, used to be called the Inter-Academy Panel. And this is a network of all the academies of science in the world. Now they have 104 members. And it is, by the way, the cream of the scientific community in the world, not only developing countries, but in the whole world. And I'm happy to say this IAP is hosted here by the ICTP. And one program that this inter-academy panel is promoting is called Inquiry-Based Science Education, IBSE. And this has been introduced for school children. This IBSE curriculum requires the student to learn scientific results through conducting experiments, through analyzing data, and the teacher in this case acts as a guide. This approach has been extremely effective in enhancing the critical thinking and problem-solving skills of students, and this is really important, how to promote the critical thinking and the problem-solving ability of the young. At the university level, and this is my view, that all first-year undergraduate students should be taught compulsory integrated courses in biological, physical, mathematical, and engineering sciences, and should develop their learning skills by looking at specific problems whose solutions require input from various scientific disciplines. That is my second point. And my third point is that international organizations and funding agencies have an obligation to assist the S&T lagging countries to improve the quality of teaching and research in universities, as I said earlier. For example, the International Association of Universities, UNESCO, UNU, the ICTP, could co-sponsor a major program that promotes twinning arrangements between universities in S&T lagging countries and world-class universities in other countries. The example that was shown to, given to us earlier by Dr. Moore about linking US universities and African universities, I think, is an excellent example to emulate. International organizations and funding agencies should also strengthen and expand their support to the small number of international centers of excellence that currently exist in S&T lagging countries. And I'll give you an example. The International Center for Water and Environmental Engineering in Burkina Faso, International Center for Insect Physiology and Ecology, as old as the ICTP, which exists in Kenya, the International Center for Genetic Engineering and Biotechnology, very recently established in South Africa, and the International Institute for Tropical Agriculture in Nigeria. We need more of these international centers, especially in the physical sciences. That's not to say that I don't like biological sciences, but I think in the physical sciences, we find very, very few international centers that exist at the moment. So there are also small groups within university departments and research institutes in the S&T lagging countries. If you look at their various departments, you do find the small groups that are working very hard to achieve excellence despite the harsh conditions that they are working under. And a number of these groups have actually been identified by TWAS using an open, merit-based, and competitive research grants scheme. About 40 such research groups, we call them TWAS research units, are currently receiving long-term funding from TWAS, about $100,000 per research group for a period of 3 years. And I think this type of program has to be encouraged and supported even further. And I know that my time is up, but I would mention another important point in supporting these research groups, and that is so far they have not been involved in PhD training program. Some of them have, but others have not. So I think in strengthening these research groups, we have to address the issue of postgraduate training. And I'm happy that Arlene is going to speak after me, and we will give you an excellent example of the regional initiative in science and education RISE, which will be described very shortly by her. With this, I stop, and I thank you very much.